historians Köprülü Fazlı, which means Köprülü the virtuous. They say of him as his high praise that he never committed a crime and that he never used an unnecessary word. They record as an instance of his eminence in taciturnity that once while Grand Vizier he received a ceremonial visit from three of the ulema who had formerly held the offices of army judges. Köprülü let them depart without having addressed a syllable to them. His old master of requests, Nigahi Effendi, said to him, "My gracious Lord, you should have spoken something to them." "I am not a hypocrite," answered Köprülü. He was austerely simple in all his habits. In his campaigns, he generally marched on foot, like the rank and file of the infantry. He disliked military music. He seldom moved his quarters before sunset. Amid the pomp and splendor of the Turkish court encamped the Grand Vizier was distinguishable by the plainness of his dress. He was an indefatigable student and read diligently in his tent. When on active service as well as in his place when at Constantinople. Such are some of the praises by which his country's historians signalize Köprülü Zade Mustafa, the renown for statesmanship acquired by him, and which Christian writers have concurred with Mohammedan in bestowing, is the more remarkable by reason of the shortness of the period permitted to him for the display of his administrative genius. He was killed in battle within 2 years from the time when the seals of office were placed in his hands. His contemporaries judge of him as of his brother Ahmed that he shone more in the council than in the field, but the military career of Köprülü Zade was highly honorable of his abilities as well as to his courage and thought ultimately defeated his gained a respite infinite importance for the Ottoman Empire by the success which he at first obtained. When he was made Grand Vizier, one of the invading armies of the enemy had advanced as far as Oskop in northern Macedonia, where it was actively aided by the Christian Albanians and their patriarch, a chieftain of those regions named Karpos had accepted a diploma of investiture from the Austrian emperor and assuming the old title of Kral had fortified himself in Agripalanka. It was indispensable to relieve Turkey at once from the foes who thus struck at the very heart of her power in Europe. Köprülü held a council of war at Adrianople, at which Selim Giray, the Khan of the Crimea, and Tekel, the Hungarian refugee, were present. Hoxha Khalid Pasha, the Seraskier of the Morea, a native of Oskop, was sent with all the regular Turkish troops that could be collected against that place. The Crimean Khan, at the head of a large Tartar force, cooperated with him. They gained two victories over the combined bodies of Germans, Hungarians, and Albanians, who had assumed the old medieval badge of the cross. The chieftain Karpos was seized by the Tartars and executed on the bridge of Oskop. Üsküp's means. Nearly all of the important posts which the invaders and their insurgent confederates had occupied in this district were recovered by the Sultan's troops, and the pressure on this vital part of the empire was almost entirely removed. Encouraged by these successes, Kublai pushed forward with the greatest vigor his armaments for the next campaign. Louis XIV, who was at war with the German Empire, sent in the winter of 1618 a new ambassador, a Marquis of Chetonev, to Constantinople, to encourage the Turks to preserve in hostilities against Austria. Chetonev was also ordered to negotiate, if possible, a peace between Turkey and Poland to prevent the recognition of William of Orange as King of England by the Supreme Porte, and to regain for the Catholics in Palestine the custody of the Holy Sepulchre, which the Greek Patriarch had lately won from them. Chetonov obtained the last object, and he found in the new vizier a zealous ally against Austria. But the Turks refused to suspend hostilities with Poland and with regard to the Prince of Orange and the English crown. Kublai answered that he should recognize the king whom the English people had proclaimed. He added that it would ill become the Turks, who had so often dethroned their own sovereigns, to dispute the rights of other nations to change their masters. In August 1619, Kublai Zade Mustafa took in person the command of Ottoman armies that advanced from Bulgaria and Upper Albania through Serbia against the imperialists. After a murderous fight of 2 days, Kublai drove the Austrian general Schenkendorf from his lines at Dragoman between the cities of Sofia and Nyssa. The vizier then formed the siege of Nyssa, which capitulated in 3 weeks. The Austrian generals were prevented from concentrating their forces for its relief by a well-planned eruption into Transylvania by the Hungarian refugee Tekeli at the head of the Turkish army. Tekeli defeated the imperialists in that province and proclaimed the Sultan as sovereign lord and himself as Prince of Transylvania. After the capture of Nyssa, the Grand Vizier marched up on Samandra, which was stormed after resisting desperately for 4 days. Vidin was also regained, and quickly then undertook the recovery of Belgrade. On the 12th day of the siege, of a shell from the Turkish batteries pierced the roof of the principal powder magazine of the city, and the destructive explosion ensued, which gave the Turks an easy conquest. Having placed a strong garrison in this important city and completed the expulsion of the Austrians from Syria, Kublai returned to Constantinople. He was received there with deserved honors after his short but brilliant campaign, in which he had compelled the invading Giaros to recede from the banks of the Morava and the Nisa to those of the Danube and the Save. On the 10th of May 1691, Kublai the Virtuous received a second time the sacred standard from the hands of his sovereign Sultan Suleiman, who died before the campaign was opened. Suleiman II was succeeded by his brother Ahmed II, who was girt with the saber of Ottoman on the 13th July 1691. The new sultan confirmed Kublai in his dignity, and the vizier proceeded to concentrate his forces at Belgrade and to throw a bridge over the Save. He then marched up to right bank of the Danube to encounter his imperialists, who under the command of Louis of Baden descended from Peter Waradin. The two hosts approached each other on the 19th of August near Salankeman. At the same time, the Christian and Muslim flotillas, which accompanied their respective armies along the Danube, encountered on the river. The Turkish flotilla was victorious, but on the land the day proved a disaster. One of the hosts of Kublai and for the host of Ottoman, contrary to the advice of the oldest pashas in the army, the vizier refused to evade behind the lines the attack of the imperialists. The veteran warrior Khoja Khalid censured this impetuosity. Kublai said to him, "I invite thee to follow me, that thou mightest figure as a man and not as a phantom." Khalid, touching the thin hairs of his gray beard, replied, "I have but a few days to live. It matters little whether I die today or tomorrow, but I would fain not have been present at a scene in which the empire can meet with naught but calamity and shame." Advanced the cannon, cried Kublai, and himself formed the Sipahis for the fight. Kemal Kesh Pasha began the battle by rushing with 6,000 Kurdish and Turkoman irregular cavalry upon the Christian lines. "Courage, my heroes," cried Kemal Kesh. "The Huris are waiting for you." They galloped forward with shouts of Allah, but were received by the Christian with a steady fire, which drove them back in discomfited and diminished masses. Again they charged impetuously, again they broke, fell, or fled. The Austrians now pressed forward to where the sacred standard was reached in the Mahometan ranks. Ismail, the Pasha of Crimea, dashed against them with the troops of Asia. His squadrons were entangled in an abattis of felled trees, by which the Prince of Baden had protected his right wing. The Asiatics wavered and were repulsed. Kuprelli saw his best men shot down round him by the superior musketry of the imperialists. "What is to be done?" he cried to the officers of his guards. They answered, "Let us close and fight sword in hand." Kuprelli arrived in a black vest, invoked the name of God, and threw himself with drawn sword against the enemy. His guards rushed onward with him. An obstinate and sanguinary struggle followed, which was decided against the Turkey by the bullet that struck Kuprelli while cleaving his way desperately through the Austrian ranks. His guards lost courage when they saw him fell, and the fatal tidings that their great vizier was slain soon spread. Disorder and panic throughout the Ottoman army. The Prince of Baden's triumph was complete, and the Turkish camp with 115 cannon fell into the conqueror's power. But the victory was dearly purchased, and the Austrian loss in men and officers was almost equal to that of the Turks. The Battle of Salankeman drove the Ottomans again from Hungary. Tekel was defeated by the imperialists and expelled from Transylvania, and throughout the 4 years of the disastrous reign of Ahmed II, the current of defeat was unabated. Besides the course of the victorious sword of the Foragians and the usual mysteries of domestic insurrection, the fearful visitations of prelates and famine came up on the devout empire. A great earthquake threw down part of Smyrna, and a still more destructive conflagration ravaged Constantinople in September 1693, heartbroken at the sufferings and shame of the state and worn by disease. Ahmed II expired on the 6th February 1695. Mustafa II, the son of deposed Mahomet IV, new came to the throne and showed himself worthy of having reigned in happier times. On the third day after his accession, he issued a Hatti Sharif in which he threw the blame of the recent misfortunes upon the sultans and announced his intention of restoring the ancient usages. At the heading, his armies in person, as the German historian observes. This document is also remarkable not to deserve citation. Sultan Mustafa II thus announced his royal will. God, the supreme distributor of all good, has granted unto us, miserable sinner, the caliphate of the entire world. Under monarch's who are the slaves of pleasure, who reign themselves to indolent slumber, never do the servants of God enjoy peace or repose. Henceforth, voluptuousness, idle pastime, and sloth and banish it from this court, while the padishahs who have ruled since the death of the Supreme Father Muhammad have heeded it not, but their fondness or pleasure and for ease the unbelievers, the unclean beings have invaded with their armies the four frontiers of Islam. They have subdued our provinces, they have pillaged the goods of the people of Muhammad. They have dragged away into slavery the faithful with their wives and little ones. This is known to all as it is known to us. I therefore have resolved with the help of the Lord to take the signal revenge upon the unbelievers that brought of hell, and I will myself begin to the holy war against them. Our noble ancestor, the Sultan Suleiman, may his thumb exhale unceasingly the odor of incense. During the 48 years of his reign, not only sent his viziers against the unclean Christian, but placed himself at the head of the campaigns of the holy war, and so took upon the infidels the vengeance which God commands. I have resolved to combat them in person, due to my grand vizier and ye others, my viziers, my ulema, my lieutenants, and agas of my armies. Do ye all of you assemble round my person and meditate well on this, my imperial Hadi Sharif. Take counsel and inform me if I ought to open hostilities in person against the emperor, or to remain at Adrianople. Of those two measures, close that which will be most profitable of the fate of the empire and the servants of God. Let your answer be the truth, and let it be submitted to me before the imperial stirrup. I wish you hears. The deliberation of the Divan on his summons lasted for 3 days. Many thought that the presence of the Sultan in the camp was undesirable. Others feared that the head only addressed them with a view of learning their thoughts. Finally, they all resolved that the departure of the Padishah to assume the command in chief of the army would not only expose the sacred person to too much risk and fatigue, but would involve excessive expense. Consequently, the Divan represented to the Sultan that His Majesty ought not to commit his imperial person to the chance of a campaign, but ought to leave the care of war or grand vizier. To this address, the Sultan returned to laconic Hatti Sharif, "I persist in marching." The most active measures then were taken to hasten the preparations for the campaign, and the gallantry of the young Sultan was at first rewarded by important success. He advanced in the summer of 1695 from Belgrade to Temeswar and recaptured the important fortress of Karansebes, Lipna, and Lugos. On the 22nd of September, he encountered near Lugos the Austrian army under General Veterani. Sultan Mustafa gained a complete victory, and Veterani and half his troops were left dead and on the field. During the winter which followed this victory, Mustafa and his counselors tiled unremittingly to dare repair the finances of the empire and to increase the number and improve the discipline of the troops. Heavy taxes were laid on tobacco and on black eunuchs and other articles of luxury. Many of the chief men of the empire seconded their sovereign zeal and raised bodies of troops at their own expense, of which they took the command. Mustafa had formed a corps of 3,000 infantry from the royal gardeners of Bostanjis of Adrianople and Constantinople. He now divided those into three regiments, which were equipped in peculiar uniform and trained with special care. The Sultan opened the campaign in 1696 at the head of a numerous and well-appointed army. He defeated the Austrians under the Duke de Saxe near Temeswar and raised the siege of that place. Mustafa strengthened the garrisons of the fortress, which the Turks still held in Hungary, and then returned to Adrianople not unjustly. Proud of his achievements, so the great Soliman, whom the chose as his model, would probably have pushed his adventures further. The hopes and pride of Turkey now began to revive, but in 1697 Prince Eugen took the command of the imperial armies in Hungary, and the crescent soon went down before him. Sultan Mustafa collected his army for this fatal campaign at Sofia and marched thence to Belgrade, where he halted and had repeated councils of war. Some enterprises of minor importance, the sending forward of detachment to reinforce the garrison of Temeswar and the occupation of reveal posts along the Danube, were successfully attempted, but there was discord among the Ottoman officers, and there was oscillation in the Sultan's will as to the main line of operations that ought to be followed. The Grand Vizier Elvas Mohammed was unpopular with the Otar Pashas, who leagued together to oppose his projects and thwart his tactics. The Vizier himself was depressed by a dream, which he saddened his equally credulous comrades. Although by narrating he dreamed at the late Grand Vizier Küprülizade Mustafa, the martyr of Selankeman, had entered his tent and given him a cup of sherbet, which the apparition had first tasted Ghatnam Prayat, the Grand Vizier, when he told his dream, that this was the cup of martyrdom which I too am destined to drink in this campaign. He wished to keep the army on the right bank of the Danube and crossing the Save, and to march up on Peter Varadin and attempt the recovery of that important fortress. The other officers proposed to cross the Danube and the Theiss and to endeavor to surprise Eugen's army, which was camped on the banks of the Basque. After much angry discussion, this last project was adopted. The army crossed the Danube and the Theiss, but it was found that all hope of surprising Eugen was idle, and the Austrians and the Turks both endeavored to gain the fort of Zittel, which is situated at the junction of Theiss with the Danube. The Ottoman obtained some advantage over the detachment of Eugen's army and sacked Zittel. They then reverted to the shame of besieging Peter Varadin and marched to Valova, where they began to construct bridges to enable them to pass to the right bank of the Danube and attack Varadin with Peter Varadin, the old bridge of having been occupied or destroyed the Austrians. Finding that Eugen had secured Peter Varadin against attack, they held another council of war and resolved to march northwards up the right or eastern bank of the Theiss and attack Szegedin. The activity of Eugen discarded this project also. He threw a strong division into Szegedin and with the rest of his army followed the Turks, watching for a favorable opportunity of attacking them. This was soon obtained. The Austrian Hussars captured one of the pashas named Jafar, who, finding his life threatened, confessed to the Austrians that the Sultan had given up his project of attacking Szegedin and now designed to cross the Theiss near center with the intention of marching upon the Hungary and Transylvania. Eugen instantly moved with all possible speed towards center in the hopes of assailing the Ottoman army while in the act of passing the river. It was on the 11th of September, about 2 in the afternoon, that the Sultan saw his great enemy approach. The Turks had formed a temporary bridge across the river, and the Sultan, the cavalry and the greater part of the artillery of his army had passed over the left or eastern bank, but the infantry was still on the western side. The Sultan and his officers had taken the precaution of forming a strong entrenchment to protect their rear. During the passage of the bridge, and 70 guns had been kept in position on the right bank for that purpose. Undaunted by this preparations, Eugen formed his columns as they came up. interline for the attack, and also at this critical time, a courier arrived from Vienna with peremptory orders to Eugene not to risk a battle. He determined to disobey his employer's order and continued his preparations for the decisive engagement. If the Ottomans had anticipated him by the resolute advance against the Austrian center before Eugene's troops had all arrived and before his artillery had been brought into position, it is probable that they would have crushed the imperialists. But this court and this order were rife in the Sultan's camp. The Grand Vizier summoned the Pashas and Sipahis, most of whom had passed over the eastern bank back to the Manzhet side. But he did not move beyond his entrenchments, and the Sultan himself did not recross the river to share and conduct the conflict. Only 2 hours of daylight were left when Eugene had completed his dispositions for action. He formed his army into a half moon so as to assign the whole semicircle of the Turkish entrenchments, and he posted his cannon where they commanded the bridge. He then made the simultaneous attack on every part of the Turkish lines, which was everywhere successful. The Turks fought without concept.